RadioPlanner 3 is a comprehensive RF planning tool that is well suited for planning and optimizing P25, DMR, and TETRA wireless public safety networks, as well as conventional analog radio systems. This video will demonstrate the main features of planning a small test P25 network in RadioPlanner 3. This project uses the default digital terrain model and clutter model, which are automatically downloaded from our server and are suitable for most cases. You can also use a custom digital terrain model and clutter data in GeoTIFF format. For more information about how to use custom geodata, please refer to the user manual. You can select one of the preset base maps or configure a custom base map by specifying a tile server URL. Map navigation is performed with a mouse. Use the mouse wheel to zoom in or out on the map. In the Map Layers menu, you can control which layers are displayed on the map. The order of the layers in the menu corresponds to their order on the map, with the base map at the bottom and sites at the top of all the layers. In the Map Layers menu, you can configure the display of sites, turn on or off coverage, routes for route study, study boundary, clutter, terrain, and base map. You can also control the transparency of some layers, and you can set the range of displayed heights on the terrain layer in automatic or manual mode. You can load and display point or linear vector objects in KML format as a layer on the map. This can include objects such as power lines, piping, etc. In this example, as a custom layer, I am using candidate antenna towers from Crown Castle, which are loaded from a CSV file. The designation used is the height of the tower in feet. Main system parameters are entered in the network menu. The system type must be set to generic TRX. Here, the downlink and uplink frequencies are set for which path loss calculations between the base and mobile unit will be performed, and the threshold signal levels up to which the calculation will be performed are also set. Here you set the maximum calculation radius from the base station. Please avoid specifying an excessive calculation radius, as this will significantly increase the calculation time. The System Parameters tab allows you to set a number of other important network parameters. All frequencies that will be used in the network are set, as well as the channel width. If your network has a large frequency grid, then you can use the autofill feature. In the Noise and Interference tab, the noise characteristics of the receivers are set. These are equivalent noise bandwidth, noise figure, and adjacent channel rejection. If your network is used for data transmission and you need to estimate the throughput coverage, then you need to prepare an adaptive modulation table. Each row of the table specifies the modulation type, as well as the corresponding signal to noise and interference ratios, as well as the throughput value. RadioPlanner allows you to predict coverage for two types of mobile devices. In professional mobile radio, portable and mobile units are often used, since they differ in both power characteristics and antenna height. Base station sites can be created in RadioPlanner in different ways: by importing points with coordinates from a CSV file, by entering coordinates manually, or directly by right-clicking on the desired location on the map. After creating the site, one sector is automatically created. In the sector parameters, the user sets the necessary parameters of the transceiver, cable, and antenna. The receiving and transmitting antenna feeder paths may have different parameters. It often happens that the transmitting and receiving antennas have very different heights and even different antenna patterns. The receiving antenna is often mounted higher on the antenna tower, which can cause the uplink and downlink budget to be asymmetrical. All this can be taken into account in the sector parameters. In the Advanced Sector Parameters tab, you can specify the simulcast delay offsets of the selected sector. By carefully assigning offsets to different sectors, some control can be exercised over where interference occurs in a simulcast system. Most often, different sites have many of the same parameters. In this case, it is convenient to use the Global Active Sector Parameters Change feature. It is enough to enter the parameters for one sector and then apply the selected parameters to all active sectors. The influence of man-made noise cannot be ignored in the VHF and UHF frequency bands, where most professional mobile radio systems operate. The calculator built into the software determines the noise-adjusted faded performance threshold for various delivered audio quality and environmental conditions. The propagation model used here is Longley Rice, but you can also choose another model. In particular, the ITU-1812 propagation model is quite suitable for such a network. In the model parameters, you can specify time and location variability. If you do not want to take into account time and location variability, then set these values to 50%. Losses for different types of clutter can be entered manually, or they can be determined using the formulas of the ITU-1812 recommendation based on the average height of different types of clutter. The height for different types of clutter is specified in the GeoData menu. Next, I will demonstrate some types of coverage prediction that are performed on P25, DMR, and TETRA networks, as well as conventional analog radio systems. Received power maps show those areas where a given signal power level is present at the receiver. The main project data and calculation parameters, as well as the calculation result at the current point, are displayed in the legend. For a portable unit, you can set from 1 to 8 different levels of received signal to simulate different reception conditions, for example on the street, inside a vehicle, indoors. For a mobile unit with an antenna on the roof of a vehicle, only one signal level can be set. Coverage prediction can be performed taking into account co-channel interference using frequency assignments for each sector, as well as taking into account adjacent channel interference using parameters in the network settings. The interference calculation always takes into account the noise component, which depends on the noise bandwidth and receiver noise figure. These settings are entered in noise and interference in the network system settings. Required service carrier to interference plus noise ratio, this is the minimum acceptable SINAR value required by the receiver for acceptable performance. Acceptable can mean a variety of things in terms of subjective signal quality, so this number can be adjusted to represent systems of varying quality or marginal quality. An area with a carrier to interference plus noise below the required one will be shown on the map as an interference zone. The best server map shows the identity of the sector supplying the strongest received signal at each location. The minimum received signal level for calculating the best server is downlink or uplink RX threshold. The sector color is defined in the sector parameters or can be assigned automatically. Areas with signal levels above both the base and mobile thresholds displays a map showing locations where both the signal received by the mobile unit is above the downlink RX threshold and where the signal received by the base station sector from the mobile is above the uplink RX threshold. This calculation can be performed for different conditions of use of a portable unit, such as indoors, outdoors, and inside a vehicle. Each condition of use has its own color and value of loss for signal penetration. For a mobile unit, only outdoor calculation is performed. The carrier to interference plus noise ratio is an essential quantity used in assessing system performance and affecting frequency planning. RadioPlanner allows you to calculate and display areas with different downlink or uplink SINR values for interference on co-channel and adjacent channels. The carrier to interference plus noise ratio is calculated by first finding the strongest received signal power at each location, then calculating the sum of received signal powers from all other co-channel and adjacent sectors, taking into account adjacent channel rejection, that also have relevant signal levels at that location. After finding the sum of interference, the carrier to interference plus noise ratio is calculated. The interference calculation always takes into account the noise component, which depends on the noise bandwidth and receiver noise figure entered in noise and interference in the network system settings. The calculation of adjacent channel interference can be disabled to only take into account co-channel interference. Number of servers area study indicates the total number of sectors that provide a signal above the RX threshold at each location. Coverage probability area study shows the availability of service based on a Gaussian or normal distribution. The calculation determines the fade margin at each study location based on the received signal strength with respect to a receiver threshold. The percent reliability is then a log normal distribution of the fade margin. Interference and noise are not taken into account in the calculation. The values of standard deviations in the calculation are taken from the coverage probability parameters, while standard deviation values in propagation model parameters are ignored. Sigma LN is the log normal large scale or shadow fading standard deviation. This value depends on the digital terrain model resolution and carrier frequency. Typical value is 2 to 5 dB for modern digital terrain models. Sigma R is the small scale fading or Rayleigh standard deviation. Typically 7.5 dB. Sigma T is the time variability standard deviation. At distances up to 50 km, the sigma T usually varies between 2 to 3 dB for land and up to 9 dB for the sea. See Table 3 and Recommendation ITUP 1406. Simulcast delay spread prediction is used for simulcast systems that transmit signals from multiple base stations simultaneously on the same channel. Interference in the receiver will occur under certain conditions related to delay time between signals arriving at a given location and their relative power. The simulcast delay spread is calculated by considering only the 6 strongest signals at any grid analysis location. The results of the calculation are displayed in microseconds on the map. For delay spread studies, the delay is calculated and displayed only when the power of the strongest received signal and the power of the second strongest received signal are within the capture ratio of each other. Typical value is 7 to 15 dB. To reduce interference between simulcast transmitters, it can be useful to artificially delay the signal transmitted from a given location using simultaneous delay offset entered in advanced sector parameters. By carefully assigning offsets to different sectors, some control can be exercised over where interference occurs in a simulcast system. The received power with simulcast interference shows the areas where a given level of signal power is present at the mobile receiver. This prediction also takes into account interference due to simulcast with a given delay spread. Areas with interference can be shown on the map in the desired color or made completely transparent. TalckOut and TalckBack area study type displays a map with the TalckOut and TalckBack locations, TalckOut only, TalckBack only, and no coverage locations for mobile unit number 1. In Area Study Boundary menu, you can specify the area on which the coverage area will be cropped. The boundaries of a rectangular area can be set manually, or you can upload an arbitrary area in KML format. The root study feature allows you to construct graphs of received power levels, carrier to interference plus noise ratio, or a throughput graph along any extended object such as a pipeline, railway or highway, etc. The route for which the calculation will be performed is loaded from a KML file. This file can be prepared in any third-party software, for example, Google Earth. There can be multiple routes. You can specify any desired value as the marker for the first point of a linear section. The remaining kilometer markers will be placed on the map along the route automatically. To construct graphs, double-click on the desired route or use the Display Route Graph tool. In the Point Analysis menu, you can see the path profile and detailed results of the received signal power calculation at any point, as well as interference levels on co-channel and adjacent channels. Click on Point Analysis, then find the required sector in the interface tree and click on it. A path profile from the sector to the current point on the map will appear. You can change the current point on the map by clicking on the desired location. The path profile shows the height of the antenna radiation center of the selected base station and mobile unit, as well as the Fresnel zone for the radio beam. Also, loss in free space, diffraction loss due to terrain, and loss on clutter surrounding the mobile unit. In the Compare Coverage menu, you can compare the results of current coverage predictions with previously performed predictions. This allows you to evaluate the impact on coverage by changing various base station and mobile unit parameters, propagation model, etc. To add a performed calculation to the comparison, click on Add Coverage to compare on the top toolbar. When you go to the Compare Coverage menu of the main toolbar, this calculation result will be located on the left side of the screen, while the result of the current coverage calculation will be displayed on the right side. If the legend is enabled, it will display calculation parameters that the mouse pointer is currently over. You can add multiple calculations to comparisons, and their names will appear in the tree view interface under Compare Coverage. Coverage prediction results can be saved as an interactive web page in HTML format that can be saved to your computer's disk or placed on a server. This web page allows you to select a base map, change scale, view basic data from the legend, and display scale and current cursor coordinates. You can save the coverage result in an image file in PNG format. Before saving an image, you can select the area of the saved coverage using the frame. You can move both borders of the frame and the map itself. If the legend is active, it will appear in the upper left corner. When saving images, you also select a resolution. The resolution may correspond with the current size or be 2 or 4 times larger. The higher the resolution, the larger the size of the save file. You can save the coverage result in the KMZ Google Earth file. If the legend is active, it will appear in the upper left corner of Google Earth. Also, the result can be saved in georeferenced GeoTIFF format, as well as in a text CSV file or exchange file map info for further coverage analysis in various GIS applications. In the Reports menu, you can create different types of project reports: Network Configuration Report, Propagation Model Report, Area Study Type, and Active Sites Configuration Report. All types of reports open directly in Excel.